once was purported to have said that the shortest distance between two points is a straight line. The shortest distance between two hearts is a song. And he realised the importance of that one-to-one, of getting the lyric and the tune through to the listener.
From the Ravel Auditorium in Nashville, Tennessee, the country music capital of the world, here's your Grand Ole Opry, starring tonight, Jim Reeves.
Railroad, steamboat, river, and canal.
The Grand Ole Opry's been on the air without having missed a broadcast for 35 years. And that speaks well. It's the world's oldest continuous radio broadcast.
Fell in love with a pretty little maid.
Every country singer, not only then, but today, will do just about do anything to get a spot or get on the Opry. Becoming a regular member of the Opry, even to this day, is most unique and most unusual, and everybody wants to do it. Jim had become fairly successful on the hayride. In fact, he was very successful and had done a guest appearance or so on the Opry. But when any artist, and many of them from the Louisiana hayride did, get to come to the Opry, it was like a highlight in their life. It's just like a step up.
I hope he doesn't come up and warp me for this, but when he came to Nashville to live and make his move to join the Grand Ole Opry, I said, Jim, I said, you know, when they see you on the Grand Ole Opry for the first time, that's the way they're going to remember you. So you're going to have to decide whether you're going to wear a toupee or are you going to just come like you are. And he thought about it, and I said, you can't come up here one night and wear it and then the next night not wear it. I said, there'll be no acceptance. So I said, make up your mind how you're going to go. He chose the toupee.
Have I told you lately when I'm sleeping, every dream I dream is you somehow. Have I told you why the nights are long when you're not with me? My darling, I'm telling you now. My world would end today if I should. I'm just no good without you anyhow. My dreams would end today if you refused me. My darling, I'm telling you.
This is Studio B in Nashville, Tennessee, and for many years I produced a lot of records here. And Jim was difficult. He was a perfectionist. He wanted to get it right, and he didn't get along with some of the musicians and singers at times, but he's great with me. I never had any, we never had any altercations at all, nothing. We played golf together and hung out together after sessions. We'd go get a beer and talk, and Jim had a great sense of humor. When people die, we forget that, how funny somebody was. Like Hank Williams, everybody thinks of him as a somber, sad character, but Hank Williams was a very funny dude. So was Jim. Jim had more old Texas sayings than I've ever heard anybody. And I never knew if he made them up or if he collected the things, but he was, and I used to say, boy, I should remember all these things, write them down. When I'd play golf going home, you know, I'd think of all these funny things he'd said.
I had not the slightest idea of what it was going to be like working for him. I just knew that I enjoyed his music. And working for him turned out to be not exactly what I expected, I suppose. He was a perfectionist, and because of this, he wasn't always the easiest man to work for. He wanted everything done to perfection his way. And you know, it was a little bit tough sometimes.
They took me to his house, we spent the night. Jim asked, did I play? Was I a musician? I said, no, these people, friends of Jim, John Ross. I said, yes, he does. And Jim said, does he have his guitar with him? I said, no. John Ross said, yes, he does. And so John went, got the guitar, because I was scared to death. Here I am at Jim Reeves' house. You know, his songs were on the jukebox, and they were being played on the radio. I mean, to me, that's a huge star, you know, so I'm petrified. So anyway, John went and got my guitar, and Jim made me sit down and play a while. And on the way back to Shreveport, John and Clara Lee Ross told me, said, when we were in the kitchen, while y'all were playing, me and Mary were, and us was in the kitchen talking, said, Jim's thinking about getting a band. Said, you don't know, but you were auditioning. I said, well, that doesn't matter. I'm not good enough. He'll never call me. But 2 weeks later, I was at John's house again, and Jim called and asked me, do I want to go to work? I said, well, do you think I'm good enough? Jim said, yeah, I think you are. I said, well, I'll be there. So I started with him. Of course, I was wasn't quite 15 yet, so I lived with him and Mary at that point. They were living in Shreveport, lived with them for 5 years.
We travel in a private bus. I have a 29-passenger diesel-powered bus that we travel in that has bunks in it, and a little lounge where we can rest and take a nap if we so desire. We do a lot of traveling and have a lot of fun.
What is the bus? That's Big Blue. And we drove many a mile in that one. But we were going through St. Louis, and there's this old woman, really slow. We were in a hurry, late for the job. And Jim jarred down on the air horn. You could see her in the car just jerk. Boy, she pulled off the side of the road. She was real old. And as we went by, she stuck up a gnarled fist at Jim and shook at it. And Jim liked to, he come unglued. He had to pull off the side of the road himself. He died laughing so hard. She was just giving it that, boy. But that's Jim. He had a great sense of humor. He wasn't putting her down or nothing, but just at that moment, the way she took it and just at him, at Jim Reeves shaking a fist, that just got to him.
Bimbo, bimbo, where you gonna go, yo? Bimbo, bimbo, what you gonna do, yo? Bimbo, bimbo, does your mommy know that you're going down the road to see a little girl, yo?
Jim Reeves actually lived with the song before he recorded it. He'd take it and study it. He'd sing it on the golf course, in the car. Many of the songs that he was thinking of recording, he'd always make it a point for me to listen to them, either on a demo or he'd sing them to me on the phone or in the car.
If he really liked the song, he'd sing it around and he'd listen to it, and then he'd put it up for a while. Put it on the shelf for a while. And sometimes he'd later go back and get it. If it hit him the second time like it did the first time, he'd say, I'm in the studio, I'll go.
When I first met Jim Reeves and started hearing him, he was singing too high. But when we did Four Walls and Anna Marie and some of those things, he sounded much better to me. And so after that, I always tried to keep him down in a low key, because he sounded wonderful to me down low. You know, I'm the one that started saying the velvet voice of Jim Reeves or something. We put out an album with that title. So the only differences we ever had was about key, and he was, he knew how well I liked his singing when he got down low, so he never argued with me, but I think he'd kid me once in a while, maybe pitch it up a little too high. And he wasn't a very good tenor, you know, but he's a great baritone.
While I sit and whisper your name, four walls to hear me, four walls to see, four walls to hear me.
That good sound on Jim's voice was, that was Jim Reeves. I mean, he kept wanting to get into the mic and get an intimate sound, because he'd been a radio announcer. He'd studied in college, you know, articulation and enunciation and everything, and he wanted to get that sound, and we could never get it until we got an engineer in who was easy to work with and would experiment and try things. And you know the reason. The reason was because if you got too close to the microphone, you might pop a P, which would make the record skip. and get records sent back to the factory and all those problems from albums and 78s and 45s or whatever we were making then.
Four walls to see.
I pulled a boo-boo.
I think he was a man who was forward-looking. He'd plans, he was forever making plans. He never was still. The music changed. His image, he wanted to change. He wanted worldwide acceptance for his sort of music that he loved, country music. And he was never given credit for that. But he was the one person who wanted to change the face of country music. And had he lived, he would have done. He created a unique fusion of country music and popular music. Jim didn't mind being called a popular singer, but he would never have wanted to be called a pop singer. He was a country singer that sang popular songs.
See, all I was trying to do was keep my job and keep from getting fired. So you make a record that sells, and you use that again, but you put something different with it. Because the friends and neighbors out there, they want something different all the time. They won't buy the same record over and over. So we would do that, and we'd try strings. If that sold, we'd continue with that.
We have our ups and downs, like all lovers do. But you know in your heart that I worship you. So don't ever think of setting me free, for you're the only good thing that's happened to me.
Gentleman Jim was an image that he liked, but when one looks at his personal side and his personal life, then perhaps it wasn't all gentlemen. He was a human being, and this is the fascination, that the image which Jim creates on wax is an image which is different at times from that which he experienced in his personal life. He wasn't always the goody-goody. He wasn't always the gentleman. There are stories of him walking off stage because he didn't like his audience. They were riding him, that he wouldn't play because the piano wasn't tuned, and promoters had problems with him. But then that's part of the music scene. It doesn't destroy my faith. It merely tells me that he was a human being like me, with a good side and a bad side.
I guess since the beginning of time, the word love could almost be traded for the word trouble, because there's a very wise